Welcome again. The purpose of inquiry and clarification is to hear what you haven't heard before, to entertain what seems to be just outrageous statements that just seem like it just can't possibly be. What are you talking about? You know, it's like, what? What? Wow. And the sometimes questions are used, but they're really statements in the form of questions. It's not like when say, who are you? That's not a question. It's not a question. So, you know, it's not like you're supposed to be answering questions. Because the truth is, you either choose to entertain questions or answers. You can't have both. You can't have both questions and answers together. And just 1 minute. Okay, and have them both there, because the answer gets rid of the question. So in inquiry, you have answers, not questions. And this is a weird thing, because usually we're dealing just with questions, because we're questioning, how do I accomplish what I'm trying to accomplish? And in inquiry, it tells you, you can't. That's the answer. You cannot accomplish it. And you say, what? And so if someone's very good at inquiry, they will say stuff that just blows your mind. It just, what? This is completely different than what I'm used to hearing. I've never heard anything, ever heard such a thing. What are you talking about? But I can tell you for sure, if you stick with it, when you hear this, you will love it. You'll say, that's exactly what I wanted to hear. Love it. Love it. Even though it's like, whoa, it is amazing. So, here we are, and we're doing this, and it does continue to progress. Like right now, I feel like love to hear this stuff. Like the I was never born. No one's ever been born. It's like, yeah, that's exactly right. Whereas before, I'd say, what? What are you talking about? So, now some will say this is only the sour grapes of older people. As they realize that the younger generation are, you know, smiling in their face all the while, they're going to take your place, the backstabbers, as it were, pushing you in, out of the picture, and then you sour grape and say, ah, there's nothing here anyway. So there's that perspective that people can have. And that gets, you know, people would say, oh, okay. Now, just sour grapes. And it's funny to look at it that way. Is that true? Is it not true? You know, we don't have to come up with an answer immediately to that. Just hearing it, though, is interesting. You say, huh, yeah. And as a matter of fact, the older generation does get mercilessly pushed out of the picture, especially now. But actually, in the past, all of this information was known in all cultures throughout history about this non-dual truth, the fact that, you know, that nothing's ever been born. All this has been known in cultures where it's very different, that the elders were respected, they were not pushed out of the way, there was like, you know, bucolic village type of situation. So, I don't think it is sour grapes. The older generation is being pushed out of the way. That's what I'm finding out now in very shocking ways, actually. Is the younger demographics cannot wait to get rid of the older demographics. I don't think there's ever been anything like this on this planet. The difference, you know. So I would say that it's not sour grapes, it's an empowerment to recognize that you're not here, you can't be pushed out of the way because you're not here in the first place. And to go into this, you know, realization of the presence of being is a perfect time to do it, actually. Perfect time. Once again, I have had some startling revelations about the younger generation and their plans to get rid of the older generation, take their place, you know, force the issue, actually. again, like a Golden Gate Bridge. This is a minor thing, but it's interesting to note. You can't pass it, go across the Golden Gate Bridge anymore with cash. So I had to sign up for a fast track account or one-time payment online credit card. Online, it's online. There are actually some cash locations somewhere, I don't know where. I guess you can drive there, but it's so inconvenient. You know, it's just prohibitively inconvenient. So what happens is there's a show of compassion, but it's so inconvenient that it, you know, it's a token thing, sort of tokenism. Kind of like a moral, something that you know, people feel, well, you know, eases their conscience, like, oh, we're, yeah, it's real tough for the people, but we have this provision, you know, kind of thing. You know, the medical, changing all the medical care, changing so many, there's so much, everything's being pushed online, mobile phones, all this stuff, you know, and most of the older generation is not interested in that at all. So there is this incredible generational divide right now. It has never been anything remotely like this in history, never. And so what is happening is a question. And what I found out actually is it's a very scary thing that's happening. And I don't want to get into it right now, how bad it could become, but it could be, genericide or something like that. Genericide, an actual getting rid of the older generation at some point. You're unhirable, you know, once you lose your job in a lot of industries. If you're older, you're unhirable. The cost of everything, it's crushing the older generation. You're getting very, very crushed. I was at the airport today, SFO. In International Airport, and I'm just watching everybody, and there weren't too many old folks around at all. There weren't too many Caucasians around at all, as a matter of fact, and you could just feel the vibrancy of the youth. They feel like this is our world. This is our world. And also, it was so unimpressive, everything, you know, all the people from all over the world. I said, oh my God, there is no special place in the world. There are no special people in the world. Everybody is just kind of blah. Everyone's blah. I didn't see any sparkle of inner grace anywhere. I didn't see anything. No, it's all just humanism people. Now, the fact is, one could say I've been searching for life on this planet. You know, all these years I've been on it like a mission, like an astronaut coming to this planet. Says, can I find any life here? And the answer is no. I haven't found any life here. Actually, there was a few great gurus, but they weren't really here. So what they said, well, their appearance is nothing, but then they're not really here at all. But other than that, there's never been any life here on the planet. This is one of those statements. You say, what? What are you talking about? It's true. It is true. And just seeing the airport and just saying, wow, I realized this isn't life. This has nothing to do with life. Okay, these are just bodies. These are just formations. Everything external, form everything, are simply formations. Just formations. What do formations make? They make other formations. But there's no life there at all. So, you may think, you know, this is, well, what's this insight leading to? Well, it seems to me to be leading to something good, really great. Just 1 minute here. Neighbor there, so very quiet. You have to keep good relations with family and neighbors, so you don't say these things like there's no life on the planet at all. to those people, because they'll think, wow, you know. And you can take time to just absorb that. There is no life on this planet. There's never been any life on this planet. That's a fact. In fact, there's no life on any planet. We've never been born. Nothing's ever been born. Nothing has ever been born. Nothing has ever been born. And you either see this easily, or you don't see it at all. You can't see it with difficulty. You cannot. Because truth is not difficult. Because difficulty implies you have questions. But where there are answers, there are no questions. When you see the answer, where's the question? Gone. When you see the light, where's the darkness? Gone. You can't have the light shining and then say, well, darkness would like to ask a question. You say, well, where's the darkness? Where's the questioner? It's like saying, well, you know, who am I? Where's the questioner who is claiming the difficulty? Is there really a questioner from the standpoint of difficulty? Or is there only difficulty? See, this is another way of looking at Ramana Maharshi's who am I, etc., like that. Is there an actual, where is the self? Is there one self in easy answers and another in difficulty? Or is there just one self who has been trying to do something that's impossible and then claiming it's difficult? Who's claiming that it's difficult? It's impossible. So the idea that there's someone who is struggling with difficulty that's other than the self is not true. It's the self, there's only one self. So the question is like, well, I'm having this difficulty, et cetera, et cetera. Well, wait a minute. Who's having the difficulty? We're assuming there's someone having the difficulty, which is a way of saying it's not impossible, because otherwise there wouldn't be a self there, because we're trying to create a new self. So if we have someone say, well, they're finding it really difficult, we're assuming that there's a new self there that is having difficulty becoming a new self or being activated. It's kind of like someone coming to Satsang inquiry and saying, I'm having a lot of trouble being activated, you know, being who I am, becoming who I am, I want to be, I'm having a lot of trouble with that. As if there's someone there already who is having his difficulty fully becoming what they are. And I think the point of this questioning of who's asking the question, etc., is to cut through that and say, there's nobody there. There's the lie that there's a difficulty in creating a new self. The fact is, it's an impossibility. So you're only choosing between the impossible and the easy. And if it's impossible, there's no self there at all. And so you don't have to find the answer for that self, or that, in other words, how do I become activated? You don't have to find that answer, because the answer is there's no one to activate. What we are doesn't need to be activated. We don't need to become something. It's already perfect, complete. It's just trying to become something different, and that's impossible. So, there is, you know, some purpose to those questions. Who am I? It's just for me. I have a slightly my context, it seems to be a little wider, and I see it from that standpoint. But you know, from a practical standpoint, maybe there's some who are better at the practicality of just centering in, you know, boring through, as it were. That's very possible. Very possible. You know, who am I? Who am I? Keep challenging. Someone says, there's nobody really there. And they say, bingo, you've got it. Well, yeah, you've got it. But then not quite. There's a continuity issue, and you know, but it's it could be helpful. It could be helpful. But what you want to do right now is to hear statements that are just over the top, off the charts, just completely just gobsmack you, just like, you know, wow. Huh? How can anyone say such a thing? That's the most valuable thing in the world right now. So those who can say those things are the most valuable people, quote unquote people. There's nobody here, actually, in the world. There's no world. There's nobody here, then how could there be a world? You know, that's a meaningful world. No, there's nothing really here. But we're pretending that there is. We're pretending there's something other than impossibility that we're looking at. We look at what we're looking at, we say, wow, a lot of difficulty. No, it's just impossibility. So the pressure, the reason why it's difficult to give inquiry satsang clarity is there's so much pressure to say something that we're used to, say something we, you know, that doesn't jar us or something, and the one has to stand up to that and say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to just relentlessly continue this. So it, you know, shakes off the, you know, this terrible spell we're under, really. And it's hard to find people like that. Very difficult. What's happened is some have their shtick of a certain, they're able to stick to just some talking points and just keep sticking with that. They're able to do that. But it's very rare to find someone who's very flexible and can just go this way or that way or that way or that way or that way. And still completely be spot on. You know, that's different. It's like someone like can play like one song on the piano. They train themselves over and over and over, and they can play it really well, but they can't play any other song. Or they can play a number of songs, but they can't improvise. Or they can't just play in a very unusual manner, in this way or that way, all different styles, all different mannerisms, and stopping, and just kind of, you know, just complete ease at just doing anything. No, it's kind of, they just have talking points, like a script, and say, okay, this is, if I just stick, you know, who's asking the question? Who's asking the question? Who's asking the question? Who's asking the question? There's nobody there asking the question. There's nobody there. There's nobody there. You know, they can do that, but so we need this type what I found out today was that I noticed a whole bunch of different patterns that I have that are designed to try and prove that I have some life, like that I'm here, that I'm alive. And one of those is suffering. I found out that the world, the ego thinks, tells you, look, you can activate what you are. Activate what you are. If you just suffer enough. If you just suffer intensely enough. If you feel, you know, deprivation. Activate you know, who you are, or something like that. Activate it. So I've noticed that that's what I've done. That's the underlying, you know, ignorance, current of ignorance there. And so you have to recognize that these currents, dynamics of ignorance, that are keeping us bound to certain patterns. And these patterns are saying, I know I can be here. I know I can be alive here. I'm just not yet here. I'm just not yet alive here. If I just do this, I can be here. You know, be born. I'm trying to be born. I'm still not quite born yet. And one of the things I use is just constant fear of destitution. So I've enabled a situation where I'm on the thinnest of ice constantly, of just breaking into complete destitution. Even though I'm not in destitution, I'm on this super thin ice. And it's been that way my entire life. From feeling like I was going to be thrown out of my house as a child for being too, you know, stubborn and obstinate and saying things that people didn't like what I'm saying now. And just to right now just being, you know, not being able, just feeling like I'm driving. I say, my gosh, if I have an accident or something, there's no way that I can pay the increased premiums or deal with, you know, the ancillary costs and stuff. Every little thing, there's no cushion. There's absolutely no cushion in any way possible that I have at all. And it's just brutal, extreme brutality. And I realize I'm doing it to try to activate, you know, to try and figure out a way to be born here. So maybe this will do it. But see, if you realize you can't be born here, nobody's ever going to be born here, no one's born here, then you don't have to put yourself through these incredible stresses and trials at all. I realize, hey, I can actually have some money and not feel, if I get a speeding ticket, that I'll go bankrupt, you know. I can't afford to pay speeding ticket. So I'm driving, I'm so scared, you know, if I don't dare get a ticket. You know, just relentless fear of just not being able to function in the society at all. It's terrible, absolutely terrible. But I have to say, you know, that I must be doing it to myself. It's a strategy. It has to be a strategy, no question about it. A strategy to try and be born. But nobody's born. Formations occur here. There's a body formation, but I'm not it. I'm not it at all. I mean, I don't feel like I'm been born alive to the world at all. No, there's a formation that's reacting to other formations, but it's not me. I haven't been born. So I'm trying to be born. I've been trying to get born. I can't figure out how to do it, how to feel really alive, can't feel truly alive. So we do all this stuff to try to feel like we're actually alive. None of us is actually alive. We are all the eternal presence. That is what we are. And that's all that we are. We're not alive. These formations, this is what we call life or aliveness. That's just the activity, the dance of energy, the dance of formations, really. And you can say, well, it's all energy. What's the point of saying that? Because if you look at it that way, you say, oh, no, it's just energy vibrating. Well, there's no meaning to it, really, then. But the purpose of energy is to produce these formations. And so we are simply viewing the activity of all these formations, and yet we're just observing. We're not really there. We're not. We realize we're not that. And so how do we become that? You know, how do we become the formations? And so we try in so many ways. The stress, the suffering, the thrills, you know, the romance, and all this stuff we're trying. I'm just trying to become alive. It's like Pinocchio, these formations, and we're not alive. See, how come I can't, truly make this formation what I am? Make it come alive. You cannot make it come alive. It's not life. It's not life. It's not what is not anything other than just a formation. Temporary formation, along with all their temporary formations, just a training program. So it looks like, in looking at it from this angle, I might be able to shed the difficulties I have. Very possible. And then maybe I could be useful, helpful in an expanded capacity. So I'm pretty sure this is correct. It is definitely a strategy that, and here's the thing. What the ego has told me, and I know is telling everybody, it is whispering to you and saying, if you succeed in what you're doing, you're going to be the firstborn, the very firstborn in the new kingdom, the kingdom of formations, because nobody's ever been born into the kingdom of formations yet. So the ego tells you, come on, you can do it. I mean, you're almost there. I mean, you'll be the first. there's another reason Jesus says the first will be last and the last will be first. The more you're trying to be the firstborn of this new creation of formations, actually, be born into this realm of formations, the more you'll be delayed and deluded. And the more you say, there's no way I can ever be born into this, the closer you are to realizing, letting go of it all, and accepting the Holy Spirit's perception of that, that solves the continuity problem. So nobody's been born, and we're struggling. Maybe we'll be the first. So I said, yeah, definitely. The suffering that I put myself through was an attempt to be the first. Be the firstborn. And that's, we're all doing that, actually. That's where our suffering comes from. Definitely, there's something in the back of my mind knows I can drop the suffering like that. I absolutely know that. All the problems, everything that bothered, everything like that, I can just drop it. And then I won't have any problems or suffering at all. And I know that's a fact, and yet I continue to suffer. So it's a strategic thing, definitely a strategic thing. So what's the goal again? To be the firstborn, to get born into quote unquote the kingdom. We think that this all these formations is a new kingdom and a new creation, and the way that we become the creators of this is to be born into it and take our rightful place. Actually, we're told that we are the creators of it, but we haven't taken our rightful place within it yet, and so we're trying to take our rightful place within it. And we cannot. There is no rightful place. We are not a formation. It has nothing to do with us whatsoever. So, it is good to know that we can literally drop the entire. Now Eckhart Tolle calls it the pain body. Okay. So we can literally drop the entire pain body instantly like that. Absolutely. Now the way that he explains it, the context he has, it is what it is. I explain it the way I explain it. That is what it is too. But it may be very much along those lines that this entire quote-unquote pain body, this whole complex of suffering, is we're doing it to ourselves to try to get ourselves born into what we think is our new kingdom that is separate from God, a new replacing the one that God created, reality replacement, and we just can't quite get ourselves born. So we turn to the goddess, to the mother, and say, Mother, please help us. Can you help us get born, please? We imagine this archetype of the great mother and pray to her, please. We still haven't gotten born into our kingdom. Please help us, deliver us, you know, into our new kingdom. And so everybody is desperately worshiping and praying, etc., etc., etc. Now the Christians think that the death of Jesus actually enabled us to be born into the new kingdom of formations, as it were. That's what they believe, actually. Because they believe, they say that God became flesh, and the proof of that is that Jesus' death proved that God had become flesh. Because if he didn't die, where's the actual proof that God had become flesh? It could have just been an appearance. But the actual death of Jesus said, oh, God definitely became a body, you know, a form like that. And that if you just believe this and accept it, then that would be the magic that enables you to be born also into this kingdom of flesh. So in other words, Jesus supposedly the firstborn, the first one of us who was born into this kingdom of formations, actually. So no longer spirit, but spirit and flesh together. That's the Christian theology, you know, which is really the ego's dream. You know, it's the dream theology. Oh my gosh, the ego dreams about that. convincing of us that this is the way to go. To believe in that, okay, which is utter nonsense, of course, because God cannot become flesh. Reality cannot become a dream. Reality, permanent, eternal life cannot become impermanent. You know, fixed will cannot be changed. You know, it's utterly ludicrous, but it's the ego's religion, it's the ego's theology, actually. And it seems to offer a wonderful solution, like, hey folks, you don't have to try to be first anymore, because Jesus already went first, and all we have to do is follow in his footsteps and accept that he did it. And just the mere acceptance that he did it, became flesh, spirit became flesh, just a mere acceptance of it is going to magically enable us to do it too. And actually, after we die, then we will all be born, we will all find ourselves in the kingdom of heaven, the new kingdom, as it were, kingdom of formations. It's the ego, 100% the ego, 100% self-delusion. Again, another attempt to get ourselves born into formation land. Which can never happen, can never. So the real teaching is no teaching at all. There's nothing to teach. There's nothing to teach, really. Because teaching aims at affecting some process, right? Basically, a change, a process. Now you can't be born. So what is there to teach? What everyone wants is to learn how to be born. You cannot be born. What we are, spirit, cannot be born. It's created. It's a creation of eternity. It is eternity itself. Eternal presence. And it can't be born. Where could it be born to? Born into what? Where? It's like the saying, how can everything turn around? You know, where can it go? Where? How can everything be born? Where is it going to be born? Some other place? No, there's nothing to teach. But hearing that there's nothing to teach is itself, you could say, it's a kind of teaching. Now, words, I found that words can either be used in a positive, yes, 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 yes sense, or no, 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 no. And people gravitate to one or the other of those ways, or sometimes a mixture of the two. It seems to me that because words themselves are so cumbersome, that they're such a terribly inadequate, you know, mechanism, words, that it's better to say no, 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 no. Use words in negative, saying no, you can't do it, it's impossible, that kind of thing. Because that goes along with words themselves. It fits you know, with the words themselves. Words you say, yes, 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 you're always struggling with, but the words don't quite, you know, don't really connote the yes, do they? They're always a no. The words themselves are always a no. So now, A Course in Miracles tends to do both, but there's a lot of yes, 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 yes there. I have seen that the teachers of A Course in Miracles, a lot of yes, 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 but they don't have the juice yet. You know, they don't have the juice yet. It seems like those have gone, no, 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 no. There's more juice there. You know, there is no teaching. Never born, there's nothing here, nothing's ever been born, nothing, no, no, nothing, never, no, no, all that. It seems that has sort of a much, you know, more powerful lack, you know, there's much less resistance there. Whereas you try to say yes, everything's wonderful, everything's beautiful, love this, love you, everything, you know, it's like, but the words themselves feel like no, 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 you know, like that. So there's kind of it feels awkward, more awkward to me. But that's not to say that you can't say yes, yes, yes. I would say it's possible. It feels awkward. But at least for me, the no, you know, saying the weirdest words to say no, impossible, is, you know, seems much less awkward. I don't feel any awkwardness there. Of course, someone will say, well, but how are you going to say yes with your no? And I say, you don't have to say yes with your no. You don't have to, no. Because, again, impossible is impossible. What do you need to say yes about to impossibility? So we're really trying to accomplish the impossible, and that's a no thing. You know, that's what we're trying to do. It's a no thing. Now we're going towards the yes of solving the continuity problem. That is true also. But in terms of recognizing what we're trying to do so that we can set it down, I would say the no, 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 no is the right way, is a better way. And then once we are able to set it down, then I'm sure there's a yes, yes, yes to what we experience then. But I think that's, don't put the cart in front of the horse. You have to recognize what it is that we're setting down, or else we won't set it down. So there does need to be this no, 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 no. And the problem is that Christianity has set up this impossible, you know, solution, magical solution of God becoming flesh, and therefore opening up the kingdom, new kingdom of formations for spirit to enter into it. Which the idea is that the teaching basically that is what we're going to do, that we're going to combine the spirit and the flesh as one. And this is going to be the new creation, something new. God's been working on this. Not true at all. But this is like a yes, 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 we can. Yes, we can do this. Yes, it's going to happen. Yes, it's been done. Yes, Jesus did it. Yes, yes. So there's all this yes, 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 based on magical, egoic, you know, fantasy. So there's another reason why the yes kind of, you know, it's like, it's better to say no. No, 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 no. That's absolutely not true that we're supposed to unite the flesh and the spirit. Absolutely not true at all. Absolutely not true that spirit became flesh. Absolutely not true. The death of Jesus' body was just the death, was just the destruction of a formation. Jesus himself was not destroyed at all. The idea that spirit died is simply untrue. It's totally untrue. Spirit, there's no way spirit can become flesh. No way, period. And so it has to be, you know, there is no way. There is no way. And we're trying to have it both ways. You know, yes and no. And so that's why I'm saying no is a little more powerful as far as recognizing the mistakes that we have made. It's a lot more powerful, I'd say. So the world keeps spinning. Everybody keeps trying to get born, trying to be born. So all on in the world, everything you see in the world is really a mad struggle of all sorts of different attempts, just trying to get born, to get born into this world. We're told that that the birth of our body means we were born into this world, but everyone has this feeling like, you know, for some reason, I don't quite feel like I got born into the world. And here's another way of looking at the I. We'll just think outside the box entirely. Really, you know, the one asking the question, here's a way to look at it. You know, I this, and then you say, who is that I? Well, that I really is the question of how come I'm not born into the world yet. I think when people come to, you know, satsang and clarity, you can look at it in that way, very simplified. They're saying, you know, I got a big problem. I said, what is that? I don't feel like I really got born. When my body got born, I don't feel like I went along for the ride. I feel like I'm not really there. Welcome to the club. Nobody's there. And so the real guru can just say, hey, no, I'm not there either. Nobody's there. Nobody got born. That's okay. That's great. And you're not bad. You know, people think there's something wrong with me. I always, you know, because we're told in the world, tells us, yeah, oh yeah, you're born. Oh yeah, sure, you're born. Yeah, this is what you are. This is your life. You're alive. Here you are. You're alive. They're just speaking to your formation, the body. And yet there's something inside of you that says, I don't feel like I'm in the world or born. In other words, I don't feel limited by this formation. I don't feel stupid like you're supposed to feel with this formation. I feel like I'm completely cosmic and multidimensional and beyond that. I feel like I'm eternal. I feel like I can never suffer. I feel that stuff is all still there. And yet you told me, and yet everyone tells me I've been born into this body with all these limitations and suffering and misery, and I'm not really there. And so we feel like misfits, you know. So you go to a satsang and say, you know, I feel like I'm a total misfit. There's something wrong with me. There's nothing wrong with you. There's nothing wrong with anybody. It's just that we keep thinking that we're supposed to be born into flesh. That's the only problem there really is. I mean, as far as this existential problem, there's a continuity problem for sure. Because we focus so much on trying to get born, we don't know what to do if we let go of this effort to be born. And so the Holy Spirit deals with that continuity issue, but we're focusing right now on this. Why do people come to satsang inquiry, clarity, clarification? What's their real problem? And I haven't heard this ever. And this is the first time I've ever heard this explanation. It's they have this, everyone has the exact same problem. It's like, I really feel guilty or wrong or something because my whole life I've been pretending that I was actually born, but I don't think I really was. So what went wrong? What went wrong? Everybody feels that way, actually. But some are very, very sensitive because they're very honest and they're aware, like, wow, all these limitations of the body, I think in reality, if I'm honest, I don't really have those. I'm just pretending to have them. So I'm this massive pretense. I'm just pretending to be a person that was born, but I really wasn't. Now what do I do? What's wrong with me? Ah, gosh, you know, it's just, yeah. Nothing wrong with you at all. There's nothing wrong with anyone. No one's ever been born. No one's ever become flesh. No one ever will. No one's ever been here. No one's ever been this limitation that we're claiming for the flesh. No one. Everybody is eternal presence. Everyone is one. Everyone is enlightened. Everyone has this complete, what some call multidimensionality, but it's even beyond that. Everybody already has that. It's just that we, you know, we're obsessed with figuring out how come we can't become flesh. That we look at this, what we are, as a problem. And I say, I can't seem to get rid of this. You know, it's just, I've tried my whole life to to be, you know, a good person and be, you know, be the flesh. And I just failed. I failed. I'm a failure. Of course you failed. It's not failure to fail to accomplish the impossible. It's not failure. Because nobody's succeeded. No one will ever succeed. So where exactly failure to what? What have you failed? Yourself? No, yourself is still exactly the same. You haven't hurt yourself. I mean, in order to be a failure, you got to have hurt something. You know, what is hurt? The flesh? Have you failed the flesh? Flesh is nothing. It's just a dance of energy formation. It's just a formation. It's neutral. It's nothing. It's not alive. It's not dead. It's not alive. It's just a symbol, like a formation of energy. So, what have we failed? You know, the question, what have we failed? What have we hurt? And I think some people recognize this and realize it, and for others it's difficult. For me, it's difficult. You know, I'm kind of like slow, you know, slow learners. Uh-huh. And for some, maybe they just say, ah, bingo, I got it. The guilt, you know, evaporates with this idea that we've really failed is weighs heavily on us. And maybe it's the slow learners who really investigate and see the full context better. Maybe they make better teachers. You know, probably. Because it seems like the ones that get like that, they expect everybody else to get just like that. And they cannot. They don't. For some reason, I've been slow with this, and so I've had to really look at it. And that's why the context is here. Because I really had this incredible complex of being a failure. Just like I'm such an incredible failure, terrible. How can I possibly fail, be such a failure? And just bring all this failure, everything, you know, just feel like a complete failure. This is like an attempt to, again, motivate me to get born. Like, come on, if you don't get born, you're going to feel this awful sense of failure forever. And the same thing with like the deprivation. Hey, if you don't get born, if you don't agree to be born, you're going to have a sense of deprivation forever. Because see, we think that somehow we're refusing to be born. That we're refusing to give our permission to be born. But the fact is, that's absolutely not true. The ego tells us, well, the reason why you're not born is you're resisting it. It's not true. You cannot be born of the flesh. It's impossible. So agreement has nothing to do with it. My cat. Agreement has got absolutely nothing to do with it. So you can't force yourself. You can't motivate yourself to be born. You can't force yourself to be born. So when you realize that, then it would seem that all these tactics you've been using, you don't need them anymore. And that's what happens. Is that you drop the tactics. You set the tactics down. Don't say, they'll never work. So it's useless. It's useless. Those tactics are absolutely useless. And when you set those tactics down, it seems like you've been born again, as it were. It's just because, like, wow, you know, you seem like a different person. You're no longer, you know, torturing yourself. The guilt complex is gone. The pain body is gone. Gone. And not to return. And then you can accept the fact, like, the way I am is fine. It's great. The fact that I'm not born of in a form is fine. I still this formation is still moving about and, you know, doing stuff and whatever. That's okay. It's just that I'm not that formation. Never will be. No one ever will be. So you see, there is an option. This option is a powerful option that we haven't, you know, really seen clearly enough yet. This notion that we're on the road to, you know, hell and destruction and war and all these things. There is this option of waking, of recognition. We can exercise that. Okay, maybe the cat is telling me that's enough. I don't know what it wants, but it probably wants some food. The formation wants some food. A lot of, you know, our prayers are basically, God, please, can you please show me the way to be born so I can get over all this guilt and suffering and misery. And God cannot help us that way. The only way that God can help us is to clarify for us that we cannot be born. So a lot of people are angry with God because God hasn't seemed to help us. Because we're asking God to accomplish the impossible. And of course the ego tells us, well, for God nothing is impossible. That's not true. God cannot destroy itself. God cannot change what it is. God cannot make lies true. God cannot make lies true. Absolutely not. And of course, doesn't need to. So that's the other side of the coin. So we're praying to God, please God, help me, help me, help me, help me, help me, help me, help me. We're really asking God, I have this terrible problem. I'm terrible guilt. I just haven't been born yet. And everybody thinks that I have. And I'm living a lie. I'm living a lie. Everybody's living a lie. So God, please help me. I feel so distraught over this. You know, can you please help me be born? And of course, God cannot help that way. But God can help by telling you, hey, you can't be born, but that's okay. And then we say, what are you talking about? You provided this body for me. You created this only for the purpose so I could be born. And now you're saying, I can't. No, God did not provide these bodies, these formations for us. Mind did. Mind did at our request to try and induce labor, as it were, to get us to be born into the realm of death and get us to be annihilated to what we are, get us to change what we are. And we cannot. It will never happen. So, you know, it's mind that has conjured up this dance of formation. Not God. But we keep thinking if we just keep praising God, you know, praise God, you know, this thing, praise of God, this so beautiful, the body so beautiful, the world, thank you God, you know. If we just keep praising Him, we think maybe God will say, okay, you deserve to be born into formation, so I'm going to birth you. You know, I'm praising you God, I'm praying to you God, and please won't you take this terrible, dreadful lie that I'm living off my shoulders and that enable me to be finally be born and never, it will never happen. It will never happen. And so eventually you have to come around to this realization because that's where God is really leading you. That's what God really teaches you through the Holy Spirit. This is the real teaching. You've been praying in vain. You've been asking God to accomplish the impossible. You've been asking God to destroy itself, you know. It cannot happen, will not happen. Doesn't matter how much praise and worship you heap upon God. Look, God, look at the sky, look at the mountains, look at the rivers. Oh my gosh. Anyone would love to be born in flesh into this world and experience your mighty creation. Your awesome, mighty creation. creation. So I just want so badly to be able to do that. God, would you please help me? I'm such a sinner, you know. I'm a terrible sinner. We all think we're these terrible sinners because we haven't been born yet. We're all just living a pretense. And what awful sinners we are. No, we're not. No one's a sinner. Nobody can be born. It's not a sin. It's just a fact. And when we have these multidimensional experiences, we always say, "Oh, I want to share this with the body, so I better figure out, you know, how can I share this with the body?" That's really like a way of saying, I hope God doesn't find out that I was, you know, enjoying what I really am. And he thinks maybe I'm a slacker. I better get back to the body. It's a way of kind of reminding us, like, uh-oh, all my prayers to God, he may reject them because I was enjoying, you know, this multidimensionality, experiencing of the presence of being. And when I next time go to pray, say, "God, I really want to be born," and he'll say, "Well, I mean, if you hadn't been slackened, you might have succeeded. You know, if you hadn't indulged in this incredible bliss, you know, you might have actually been born of flesh by now." So, you know, we got this, you know, complex of we don't dare experience bliss even for a moment because we think that'll, you know, God will be angry at us and invalidate us. Say, "You're not really serious about being born. You know, if you were serious, you wouldn't have allowed yourself to backslide into the old ways," the old ways of bliss and being, eternal being, eternal presence, the old ways. "How dare you slip back in the old ways? I told you, my command is you must go forth and be one with the flesh." So, you know, and you think, "Oh my gosh, I'm really a bad sinner now." Okay, cat. Oh, yeah. So bringing this whole guilt complex, sin complex, bringing everything up like this is we can just look at it. Say, very interesting. And it is very interesting. I'm enjoying looking at this with you, absolutely. And this is the first time I've ever seen this, you know, and this clearly. It just isn't really talked about in this way. So I'm just like enjoying it. Wow. What a promising perspective to look at it this way. And of course, if we stay in the bliss, then we'll say, "Oh my gosh, I've lost any hope of ever being born into the new kingdom at all. No way. Because I've completely forgotten. I've lost my will to do it. I'm not motivated anymore. You know, I'm enjoying this bliss so much. I've really forgotten all the tactics and tricks and stuff that I had done before. It's like, oh my gosh, I'm ruined. I'm ruined forever. I'll be excluded from the new kingdom, all this stuff." All this guilt, it weighs on us, And of course, it's self-imposed. We wanted to be prime creator. We wanted to change what we were. So we've imposed all this madness on ourselves, this guilt trip on ourselves. But we can recognize it, notice it, and then hopefully at some point we'll you know, throw it in the trash. We might need a dumpster for it, actually. We might need a big dumpster. But, you know, dumpsters are available. So you can drop the pain body. You don't have to explain it the way Eckhart Tolle explains it. That this is obvious, but I'm giving sort of a different explanation for it here. And that's useful because not everybody gravitates to the same style. You there's a lot of good music, and you know, in other words, but not everybody, like, people have preferences, you know, in styles, so that's okay. No, some gravitate to the use of words. Yes, 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 yes. Well, okay, you can reach the mountaintop either way, but you still can't be born. See, still can't be born. And it's like people gravitate. Let's say they listen to Eckhart Tolle, drop in the pain body. You know, what I've seen is a lot of people gravitate to it. They say, okay, Eckhart, if I drop the pain body, can I be born then? Will that enable me to be born? You know, that's what, you know, that's what comes out. So there gets so much gravitation around that, that, you know, other people say, wow, that's not quite it. And then some other thing comes along that has got a, you know, a different, you know, the context is styled slightly different. And then people say, ah, okay, there is hope, you know, hope that I can get free of this whole complex. So it's very funny, you know. I think any teacher, anyone who realizes, gives up the effort to be born, everybody, you know, comes to them, in the back of their mind, they're saying, okay, if I give up the effort to be born, will that enable me to be born? That's what they really are looking at, because the guilt complex is still there. And, well, we won't get into spiritual politics at this point. We'll see, because, you know, perspectives can shift and change on that. And you don't have to do it any particular way. I know there's always a demand, like, this is the way, because people think, oh my gosh, if I just tell everybody this is the way, then I can be born. You know, there's always that motivation behind people who have not given it up. Because it seems as though you set the whole thing down all at once. So until you've set it down, there is still this immense guilt complex, fear complex there. It's still there and still driving people. And it's a great strain to struggle against that complex and not set it down, actually. I feel terrible strain. And most people would not put up with this strain. They'd say, forget it. And again, that strain is probably, again, to try and get born. It's probably that too. So but the real guru recognizes that everyone that comes to them, I say that they're trying to kill the guru. That's one way of putting it. Make sure the guru dies. It means they want to help the guru be born. They want to validate, oh, the guru found a way to be born, so I can find the way now. And the guru says, drop the pain body. They say, okay, in order to be born, I have to drop the pain body. So how do I do that? And the guru says, no, no, no. Dropping the pain body occurs when you realize you can't be born. And they say, what? Okay, I don't understand that part. But meanwhile, let's work on dropping the pain body so we can be born. You know, it's just like complete disconnect. A teacher scratches her head and says, how could these people, you know, they don't get it. Why would they miss the message? Because there's this tremendous guilt complex, tremendous failure complex, feeling like, you know, what's wrong with me? God, I'll be excluded forever. God will hate me if I don't do this. If I give up, I'm a loser, a complete loser, all this stuff. And I think that this has to be looked at more carefully. A Course in Miracles helps us look at this very well. This whole guilt complex that we have severe feelings like, we'll let everybody else down. We'll set a bad example. You know, we're setting a bad example by giving up this quest. If we just keep trying, there must be a way. You know, all this guilt is piled on us. We're buried in it. And so most people think, man, it's just too tough. Let me just find a way to get born and be done with it. And so if here's a guru, they must have the answer for me. And You know, it takes them a long time to finally realize that the guru doesn't have the answer for them. In that way, it does have the answer, but not the answer how to be born, the answer that you can't be born. And then eventually people kind of get disillusioned and say, ah, you know, I spent all this time with the guru and they don't have the answer I'm looking for. Of course not. They do not. They don't have the answer how to do the impossible. They've just given up the quest. You know, give up the quest. We're all questing. We're all questers. Give up the quest. Give up the quest. Give up the search for the answer, how to be born. Give up the quest. There is no answer. Give up the quest. Stop being questioners. Questers, questioners. We're questioners. Questing, questioning. How do we do it? How do we do it? How do we do it? All questions are basically, how do we do it? How do we do it? So instead of saying, who's asking that question, we say, what's the question really? And you ask this, what's really the question? There's another way of doing it. What's really the question? And the question is, you know, how do I do it? How do I do this? I gotta do this. How do I do it? And Guru says, you don't have to do it because no one will ever do it. So you're in good company by not doing it. You're in fact in perfect company. You're in total oneness company. And they say, yeah, but Jesus did it. No, Jesus did not do it. That's made up by the ego saying that Jesus did it. No, it's not true. Nobody will ever do it. Spirit will never be born and become flesh. Spirit will never become flesh. Not at all. So you're in perfect company. And so the question, like, well, who's asking the question? No, what's the question really? What are you really asking? Yeah, let's not, you know, that's how I see it, at least right now. Maybe this is just a variation, maybe both can be used, etc. But I feel this is a very valid variation of what's the question really? What are you really asking? Be honest, say, how can I do it? How can I get rid of this lie I'm living? How can I really be born? You can't really be born, that's the answer. And they say, oh my gosh, I'll be stuck with this guilt forever. No, you won't. So that's when you have to look at the guilt. And see, that takes effort. People want the easy answer. They say, just tell me how I can be born. I'm sure you got a secret. There's no secret to it. There's no secret. You can't be born. So there is this guilt complex. You have to get rid of that. And that's hard work. I found that to be hard work. Most people don't want to do that work, so they're just trying to find the answer how to do it. And they say, don't bother me with all this other stuff. It's too tough. It's too tough for me. I don't want to deal with it. Nothing can be done in that case. And really the success is you get up in the morning, you say, ah, it's too tough. I don't want to deal with it. And then gradually during the day, you realize you're another day of misery and failure. And then you say, oh man, I got to at least dig a ditch, you know, some ditch today. I got to work a little bit. And then you work on it and you make some progress on it. It's not like anybody says, oh great, I get to work on the guilt complex. How wonderful. No. It's the work is too hard. You know, it's more like you just say, wow, I'm just torturing myself and it doesn't work. And I'll keep torturing myself forever unless I look at this guilt complex. And so I better, you know, do it. But certainly it's frightening to look at it, actually. Because you think you're going to be excluded forever from the new creation. You're a complete failure, you know, and a complete reject. That's the fear. That's the fear. And we don't, we're so scared of it, we don't even want to look at it. So some will look at it a little bit and say, oh, that's too tough. And then, okay, let me find another guru, one who's got the answer how to be born. And off they go, kind of thing. So, yeah. And some will have work on it a little bit and they say, wow, that was really tough. I don't think I want to do that again. And then others whose strategy to try to get born is so vicious, they're just suffering so terrible that they say, you know, I just have to get free of this. That's my case. I mean, my effort to be born was so vicious that to myself that, you know, I just had to say, you know what, I can't do this forever. You know, and it's not working. and I don't see any success, and I better get this figured out. Otherwise, you know, it's intolerable. So then I had to look at the guilt complex. I had to look at all this stuff, just because the suffering was too terrible, really. But without that, I don't think so. I would have looked at it. No, I don't think. And usually, it's people who are suffering really badly that decide, you know, I need to really look at this. I cannot keep torturing myself like this. It's just too much. But most people are kind of happy. And, well, I got this little secret problem. You know, I feel kind of like I'm living a lie. But can you solve it for me? And no, you can't solve it. Okay, on to the next. And they don't really get into it. So that's just, you know, business as usual in the world. So looking at the guilt complex is super important, which I've done in these videos to a very large extent. There's this dread, this terror. The dread of discontinuity, you know, is the mother of all those dreads. But we think that this discontinuity is a result, is our punishment for failing. It's our punishment, you see. Instead of, it's just discontinuity. The ego tells us that's your punishment for wanting to go back home. And you can say, no, that's just the discontinuity. That's just the ego's solution to being born. It's just to entertain mutual exclusives. So the sorting this out is important. So I still have to do that. I can feel a little bit of work is still there, actually. So yeah, more hard work. You know, what else is new? What else is new? Everybody wants to avoid it, of course. They think everyone thinks they're smart enough to avoid it. Nobody's smart enough to avoid it. Because nobody's smart enough to be born into the flesh, because it's impossible. So nobody can avoid it. Nobody. Have to sort this out. And the ego's secret of how to be born into the flesh is actually entertaining mutual exclusives, which leads to this complete mental chaos, which then the ego claims is our punishment. The reason it's there is punishment for our desire to return back to reality, to give up the quest. And they say, well, see, you're a bad person. If you weren't such a bad person, if you weren't a slacker, you wouldn't have experienced this mental chaos. That's a lie. It is the entertaining of mutual exclusives automatically gives rise to this. It has nothing to do with you being a slacker or blah, 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 blah. Absolutely nothing. So the ego completely lies about this. And so then you think, oh my gosh, see, that's the penalty of wanting to drop this effort. So I don't dare drop the effort or I'll experience that again. No, that's a lie. Very profound. So this inquiry here is actually, I'm doing it on camera, actually showing you live, you know, what it's like to actually focus in. And you see, you do have breakthroughs. All you have to do is turn your attention and say, okay, let me turn my attention there. And then let the intention work. And then suddenly you'll say, oh, I see what's going on. It's the unwillingness to turn the attention there that's the problem. It's kind of like someone's, you know, covering their eyes and saying, I can't see. Gotta take your, you know, blinders off. You say, oh, I can see. There's no way to explain to somebody who's got the blinders on, you know, what's really there. You gotta turn your attention there. And there's an unwillingness, like a fear, like I better not do it. So we say, can you please explain to me without me having to turn my attention there? No, you have to turn your attention there. You have to turn it there. So I'm just showing you it's possible. But you do have to do it for yourselves, no question about it. See, the ego says that the discontinuity that you experience and mutual exclusives is proof that you are a reject. It's saying, you're one of the ones that is not going to make it. You're a reject. Because, you know, that's the proof right there. And then you have to be, you know, you have to eventually see, no, it's proof that the ego's advice is the reject. And nobody will ever enter into the flesh. No spirit will ever enter the flesh. It's impossible. And the ego's advice is what's giving rise to this chaos, not the fact that I'm some sort of reject, or there's something that I'm flawed or anything, less than perfect. No, the mind is still perfect, I'm still perfect. So, yeah, this is like a gate to go through, actually. It's like I've just discovered the gate that goes straight and narrow, the small gate that goes past the whole situation. But that's the ultimate threat the ego has been holding up. That it tells you you're going to experience this again if you don't get with the program. If you try to give up again, it's certain you'll experience this. Not true. Not true. But it may be that the Holy Spirit provides, you know, this alternative perception, so we don't have to challenge this thing completely. That may be the case. That's what I'm looking at, because the fear is so severe that you're going to get this. You might get this again. That you're not willing to even attempt it. That's very possible. So if you try to give up once, you lose your nerve at the last second, the ego says, don't worry, I got the answer for you, mutual exclusives, then you experience the chaos. That's what I felt. I tried to let go of everything, and I guess I almost succeeded, and then the last second I had this continuity worry. The ego jumped in with this mutual exclusive saying, here's the solution for you. It created this horrible mental chaos, and then the ego blamed that on myself, saying, well, that I didn't, you know, the ego says, well, I didn't realize that you were such a terrible person, such a terrible reject. That's why you're experiencing this. And that's what the guilt trip is laid on me. And so then back of my mind, I'm saying, well, if I try to let go of everything again, this might happen again. So maybe that the Holy Spirit provides something that eases this concern. Gives you a chance to really, you know, get past this without actually trying to just drop everything like that. That's possible. I'll have to see. Knocking on the door right now. Definitely at the door. This is the very root dynamic of the ego's lie, of how it tries to pin this chaos on saying that you're you know, you're no good. And the ego claims, I didn't know that, because the ego says, well, this would have worked. It works for everybody else, but it didn't work for you. I'm sure it works. So you must be one of those, you know, rejects. There's some certain people that rejects. The ego says some souls are rejects, and you're obviously one of them. Yeah, that was a total lie. Every aspect of spirit that tries to entertain mutual exclusives will have the same experience of the sense of complete mental chaos. It has nothing to do with being a reject at all.